This is another early morning screencast, so I apologize ahead of time for any coughing and sniffling. This is the same screen that we left in the last screencast. And just as a quick reminder, when we talk about diffusion, we're talking about going from a high pressure to a low pressure. And that occurs naturally. That we're going to learn more about that when we talk about the second law of thermodynamics, that things go from order to disorder unless you do work on it to make it go the other direction. And we observe this all over the place, both in the way in which our locker naturally seems to get messier, where our bedroom or the kitchen or our jeans wear out and fade, things go from order to disorder. Of course, with jeans, the more disorder in the jeans, the more expensive they are. But that is neither here nor there. Now, this idea of going from high pressure to low pressure continues until you reach something called equilibrium, which hopefully you remember from your chemistry days. And we can talk about the speed at which you go from high pressure to low pressure by Fick's law right here. And as you might guess, your change in concentration, the bigger the difference from your high concentration to your low concentration, the faster things will diffuse. And the high concentration, in a sense, you could say you have a higher pressure in that region because you have more particles banging into each other and into the sides of the container. It also depends on the cross-sectional area, like we said before. The broader or larger the pipe, the hose, the tube, whatever it is, the easier it is for particles to have a net migration from high to low concentration. But the longer you have to travel, obviously the longer it takes to reach equilibrium. Just like the farther away you need to travel in your car, the longer it's going to take you. So this is where we then pick up with some stuff that, some content that directly relates to biology. And we begin up here about how important understanding diffusion is if you're going to understand biology. Diffusion through a cell membrane, you remember that a cell, there are plant cells, there are animal cells, and there are single-celled organisms, has the outer membrane that separates the organism from the environment, and not for bacteria, but for most other organisms that have a nucleus, there's a nuclear membrane on the inside. And the DNA, as you might recall, is inside that nucleus. So particles have to move back and forth through the outer membrane, the cell membrane, and particles have to move back and forth across the nuclear membrane. These particles might be the building blocks that are needed or the nutrients that are needed coming in, or they might be the waste products or the products that are the result of building something that are needed elsewhere in the body. And of course, the nuclear membrane protects the DNA from the rest of the cell, but particles have to move in, for example, RNA to make copies of the DNA, and then has to move back out again. So when we talk about cellular metabolism, we are talking about how the cell lives and functions, how it gets its raw materials, how it gets rid of its waste products. And it can be greatly simplified by saying what we need is oxygen to get into the cell, and we need to get carbon dioxide and other waste products out of the cell. And then inside the cell are where big molecules are broken down into smaller ones, and smaller molecules are constructed and put together into bigger ones. So you're both synthesizing and breaking down compounds in the cell. under the instructions of the DNA. So that's an overview of something that you already know. Now, sometimes the movement of materials into the cell, well, that just erased everything, that wasn't good. But sometimes if this is the membrane right here, and let's say this is inside and this is outside the membrane, as we go from outside to inside, that can occur naturally when you're going from high concentration or high pressure to low concentration or low pressure. A good example would be oxygen. When oxygen is brought to the cell, the concentration of oxygen outside the cell is greater than the concentration inside the cell, because inside the cell, the oxygen is being reacted and it's getting used up. Meanwhile, the waste products like carbon dioxide that accumulate inside the cell will be in a higher concentration than outside the cell, and so the carbon dioxide will naturally diffuse outward. And the same directions are true for other compounds that are brought to the cell or taken away from the cell. But you might remember in biology that a lot of times we want to move against the concentration gradient. We want to go in the reverse direction that the materials naturally want to go. And when that happens, you need certain proteins in the cell membrane that can actively transport materials against the gradient. So, for example, if things want to go naturally from inside to outside, these proteins here, using up energy, can actually make things go against the gradient, where you need a higher concentration, and that's called active transport. We're not going to be talking about active transport. We're going to be talking about the natural diffusion. Now, to oversimplify the shape of a cell, let's talk about a cube. And you might remember this is one of the first activities or discussions that we did in a screencast over the summer when we were looking at the relationship between length and surface area and volume. And if you look at a cube, you have the side of a cube, but there are five other sides of the cube. And if the sides of the cube are L, the area of a side is going to be L squared. And so since you have six sides, you get 6L squared for the surface area. And then the volume is going to be L cubed. And we put that in the denominator here. And so you can see that the surface area to volume ratio, for a cube anyway, can be simplified to the fraction 6 divided by L, where L is the length of a side. And what's very important is that you have a sufficient surface area to volume ratio. By sufficient, I mean if your volume is too big, it's very, very difficult with a proportionally smaller surface area for the materials you need to diffuse through the cell membrane and eventually get all the way to the interior of the cell, and for the waste products forming on the interior of the cell to eventually get to the cell membrane and diffuse out, because accumulation of waste products could kill the cell. So you need to have a large enough surface area to volume ratio. And cells, you have about, give or take, 30 trillion cells in your body, anywhere from 10 to 100 trillion based on your size. So 30 trillion would be a good number. That would be 30 times 10 to the ninth cells. And each cell is about a millionth to several millionth of a meter. So that would be 10 to the minus sixth. And so the surface, the cell's typical surface to volume ratio is about a million, about a million. So cells can't get to be too large. Now, in order for things to move across the cell membrane, obviously there needs to be holes in the cell membrane or pores through which the materials can transport. So if I make a cell membrane with little holes in it, and right there you can, that little gap there is going to be a pore, an opening. So you're going to have some particles like this, and maybe there's only a few on the other side. And so this is your high concentration, and this is your low concentration, or you could say that this is the high pressure and this is the low pressure. And even though some particles will move from right to left, most particles are going to move from left to right until you reach equilibrium. And that's moving across this cell membrane naturally under the laws of thermodynamics. Now, you might also have some bigger molecules. They could be sugar molecules or proteins or something like that. And they may not be able to get through that opening. And if they can't get through the opening, they remain on the left side in this drawing. And what often happens then is that the fluid, the water, will go from the higher concentration, where the large particles aren't in great abundance, to the lower concentration of water. On this side, you might have like a 99% water. And on the left side, let's say you have a 90% water. So you'll have a net flow of water in this direction. And that creates a pressure from this side on the cell wall. So this is all a review of stuff that you have learned in biology. And we say that this membrane is selectively permeable. In other words, it allows, by virtue of the size of the pores, certain particles to migrate and diffuse through the pores, and other particles, because they're too big, or maybe they have a wrong charge. Charges also play a role. If this region right here around the pore is a positive charge and your particle has a negative charge, it might be able to get through, but if it was a positive charge, it might not. So there are different reasons that create a membrane that is selectively permeable, but the size of the pores would be a big one. Now, osmosis is the diffusion of water across a selectively permeable membrane. Water molecules are very, very small by comparison to a lot of the types of molecules in the fluid of a cell, in the cytoplasm. And so water molecules generally will very easily go from where they are in higher concentration to where they are in lower concentration. Now, this is very important, for example, in medicine. If you imagine, again, somebody getting a transfusion, in other words, they're lying in their hospital bed, and there's a tube connecting to a needle in the arm that goes up to a bag dangling from a stand. And in that bag might be a glucose solution, or it might be a salt solution, or it might be a solution that has some medicines and antibiotics in it, or a combination of all those things. And you want the concentration in that bag to be the same as the concentration of the human blood. You want it to be isotonic, where iso means the same, and tonic is the old-fashioned word for concentration. If that's not the case, and you have a difference in concentration between whatever it is dissolved in the bag, the fluid in the bag, compared to what's dissolved in the human blood, such as blood cells and antibodies and immunoglobulins and platelets and salts and so forth, when those two concentrations aren't the same, bad things can happen. For example, if the concentration in your bag is lower in terms of the materials in it than the concentration in your blood, that means the concentration of water is going to be just the opposite of that, and the water is going to diffuse or will go through the tube, through the needle, into the blood. And if the fluid going into the bloodstream has an awful lot of water in it, it's going to cause a red blood cell, where it has a low concentration of water, to the dilute fluid that's being brought in with the plasma and mixing with the plasma outside the blood. And so the water is going to go from where the blood is in, the water is in higher concentration outside the cell to where it's in lower concentration inside the cell, and then the cell is going to inflate, and it could inflate to the point where it bursts. That's called hemolysis when we're talking about blood cells. Hemo for blood, lysis for bursting or breaking. Plant cells don't have to worry about this because plant cells also have a cell membrane that's usually somewhat geometrical that protects the plants from hemolysis. So plants can handle some amount of flooding. In fact, some plants can live in water itself. Now, in the other case, if your concentration of stuff in your bag, your IV solution, intravenous solution, is too low a concentration in water because it has too high a concentration of materials, then compared to a red blood cell, and let's make the red blood cell red to help. There's my red blood cell. So this would make the water on the outside lower than the water that's on the inside, and the water will go through the cell membrane very easily to the lower concentration on the outside, and then your cell is going to shrivel up. And when it shrivels up, then again, that could kill the cell. That's called crenation, if you remember your biology. Now, other things are going on besides cell membranes that involve diffusion. And one is all the diffusion that goes on in the nephrons, the kidney cells of your kidney. And of course, many, many waste products have to be filtered out from the kidney, and they have to be collected in a duct, and then it travels to your bladder, and eventually you urinate all those waste stuff out. And when people who have damaged or diseased or have lost a kidney, they often need to have assistance with a diffusion apparatus here, which you might call it an artificial kidney or kidney dialysis machine, to do the filtration for you. And once again, the idea is to get the unwanted materials in the plasma of the blood to diffuse from high concentration in the blood, which would potentially kill the individual, to the lower concentration over here, and then it can be removed from the body and the person can live a relatively normal life. All right, let's talk about motion through a viscous medium. You can imagine if you had a graduated cylinder and you filled the graduated cylinder with water, you took another graduated cylinder and you filled it with oil or molasses or honey, and in both of those cylinders you dropped a marble in them. Well, water is not very viscous, and the marble would drop very, very quickly. Whereas in oil or honey or whatever, the marble would fall much more slowly because of the greater viscosity of the fluid that it's traveling through under the influence of gravity. So just like you can have an object reach a terminal velocity when you drop it in air, and that would occur, of course, when the force of gravity, if this is my object right here, and it's dropping through air, it's got a force of weight, you remember this. And at some point, the force of friction equals the force of weight, and you reach a terminal velocity. And so it's no longer accelerating. Well, the same thing can be seen when you drop something in a denser fluid, not air in this case, but water or oil or molasses or honey or something. And it's going to reach its terminal velocity much, much faster because of the viscosity of the fluid that the object that's falling is going through is much greater than the viscosity of air. And also much greater than the viscosity of water. So back in 1845, a guy named George Stokes, an Irishman, found that the magnitude of the resistive force, and the resistive force is designated right here. I might use like F sub F for friction here, but they're using F sub R for the resistive force. On a very small spherical object of radius R, falling slowly through a fluid of viscosity eta, ETA. ETA is the name of that Greek letter. It also stands for estimated time of arrival. I guess we could make a joke about that if I worked on it, with speed velocity. And you can see then that your force of friction is going to be directly proportional to the viscosity. It's going to be directly proportional to the radius of the object. The bigger the object, the greater the force of friction, because you have a greater surface area that's encountering the fluid. And the velocity is going to be directly proportional also. This is called Stokes' law. And this speed, by the way, is the terminal velocity, not the actual speed. So in any case, this equation, therefore, should make sense the way it's constructed. And the 6 pi at least the 6 part would come from the calculus. Now, building on this idea for measuring the resistive force of an object through fluid is Robert Millikan. Robert Millikan received a Nobel Prize in physics back in 1923. And we'll talk more about him in a later chapter on electrostatics, because he's famous for coming up with a device over 100 years ago for calculating the charge to mass ratio of an electron, which is quite a feat. He studied under a guy named Albert Michelson, who also got a Nobel Prize in 1907, who calculated the speed of light over 100 years ago, again, which was no small feat back then with the equipment available to them. And it gives you a good example of how Stokes' law from way back in the middle of the 19th century, and Robert Millikan in the early to middle part of the 20th century, and his mentor, Millikan, all of these gentlemen at different times, sometimes they know each other, sometimes they don't, but you can see how physics and any other science builds and builds on others. Isaac Newton is famous for saying, among many other things, that if I appear to see farther than most men, it's because I stand on the shoulders of giants. And the point being that any scientist, just like any human being, should always be humble, because whatever we know or can accomplish is always because of the assistance and the insights and the help and the circumstances created by lots and lots of other people. We all need to be humble. By the way, both George Stokes and Robert Millikan were devout Christians. So let's move on. Let's look at this diagram over here to the left. And we have three forces acting on this greenish sphere, some object that is falling through a viscous medium. It's kind of beige looking. And those three forces would be the resistive force, right there, and the force of weight acting down, and the buoyant force acting up, which we studied earlier in the chapter. Now, the force of weight, and we've seen this before, the force of weight, which is mg, and of course, the mass can be turned into density times volume from the equation for density. So we get this equation right here. And then volume for a sphere is 4/3 pi r cubed. So that's how we can measure the weight, one way to measure the weight of the sphere. And then down here we have our buoyant force. And our buoyant force depends upon the weight of the displaced fluid. And so that means we're going to need to know the density of the fluid. Right there is the density of the fluid. By the way, right up here is the density of the sphere. So make sure you distinguish between the two. And again, being a sphere, you have 4/3 pi r cubed. So that way we can find the buoyant force. So let's check these off. We've got the force of weight right there. We've got the buoyant force right there. And up here, we've got the resistive force. And so we can put all of those things together, set them equal to each other when you have terminal velocity, so that the up forces equal the down forces, solve this equation for the terminal velocity. And as you might expect, your terminal velocity is proportional to your change in pressure. There's your change in pressure. Your terminal velocity is going to be proportional to the radius, in fact, the radius squared, which you can see right there. And your terminal velocity is going to be inversely proportional to the viscosity of the fluid that it's trying to go through. Now, an offshoot of this is to consider the more common scenario if your object is not spherical and you have an irregularly shaped object. And there are many, many examples of this. But once again, we've got our equation of equilibrium, up equals down. And this time they're doing the down equals up in terms of order. And here's my buoyant force again. Here's my force of weight again. And we can set these equal to each other down here and solve for velocity. And this is the terminal speed for particles, very, very small particles in biological samples. And that speed, the terminal speed for blood cells, for example, falling through plasma is about 5 centimeters per hour. 5 centimeters is about, there's 2.54 centimeters in an inch. So 5 centimeters is about 2 inches. So red blood cells falling through blood and the plasma of the blood travels at about 2 inches per hour, not very fast. And these materials, as they fall through the fluid, we call that rate the sedimentation rate, the rate at which these sediments, these solid particles, settle down through whatever liquid they're going through. And we take advantage of that when we use a centrifuge. Here you're looking at the centrifuge from above, and this object is spinning around in a circle very, very rapidly. Here's your test tube right there. And originally you would have a tube that was uniform in concentration. The sediments were evenly distributed throughout the test tube. And then as you spin it very, very fast, the sediments rapidly, rather than naturally and slowly, end up at the bottom of the tube because of the inertia that is created. And you can measure that speed as well. And as you might imagine, the speed at which the sediments travel as terminal velocity is going to depend upon the angular velocity of the spin of this centrifuge. And then you have the comparison of your density. Coming over here, we have the final section in this chapter. The deformation of solids. And as we look at the deformation of solids, we're going to look at this in one dimension, in two dimensions, and in three dimensions. We need to establish some vocabulary words here. We're talking about solids, which when you apply a force to them, distorts the solid. But then when you remove that force, the solid returns to its original shape. And we call that looking at its elastic behavior. And the elastic properties of these kinds of solids are often talked about in terms of stress and strain. You might think that you're experiencing a lot of stress as you strain to do your work and accomplish all your goals by the appropriate deadlines. Well, in physics, we've always had stress and strain. So we say that stress is proportional to strain. And that proportionality constant is called the elastic modulus. And we'll develop an equation for that a little bit later. But we're going to have to define what is stress, what is strain, and then the proportionality constant is called the elastic modulus, and it depends upon what the material is. So we're going to look at one dimension. Why did I do significant digit there? We're going to look at one dimension, tensile strength, two dimensions, shear strength, and three dimensions, bulk or volume deformation. And they're all based upon this idea right here, that force is proportional to the stretch. Think of a spring, which we've had already. The greater the force, the greater the spring is going to pull back. It's going to be harder to stretch the spring the farther you stretch it. And that's where we get the negative sign from, because we're talking about not the weight of the object that's causing the stretching, but the resistance to the stretch of the spring as it wants to go back to its original location. So the force and the displacement, delta x, are proportional, and our spring constant is k, and the negative sign is because we're talking about the resistance to that applied force. So in other words, it's in the form of the equation A equals B times C. And that's what you're going to see as we go along. Or another way of saying this is that my constant, whatever it is, my modulus, is going to be my stress over my strain. To oversimplify it, saying the modulus B equals the stress over the strain, the ratio of the stress to the strain. So as we move along here, the stress is going to be a force. And the strain is going to be a relative expression of the degree of deformation, of being stretched. And when we talk about pressure, we're going to be using the Pascal, which is broken down into force per meter squared. Remember, pressure is force per cross-sectional area. We could further break the Newton down into its fundamental units. The Pascal is our unit of pressure, and it's a Newton per meter squared, as we usually talk about it. And you might remember, for example, air pressure is about 1 times 10 to the 5th Pascals. That's just air pressure. So my stress, then, is the force that I'm applying per cross-sectional area. And in this picture, we're looking at this as my stress. Notice that this arrow up here is locating along the axis, the long axis of the bar, the rod, the wire. So we're talking about one dimension. The strain is right here. It's how much you change the length of this wire or this rod compared to its original length. L sub all, O often means original or initial. And then your modulus is right there. So you can see that this equation is in the form of A equals B times C, A equals B times C. Or we could say it's in the form of Hooke's law, which is force equals negative K times change in X. It follows that same form. This is called Young modulus. I first encountered Young's modulus in December of 1970. I was taking physics at college, or maybe it was 71, I don't remember. And we'd not even gotten to this chapter yet. And we get our exam. It's an all-written exam. And it's a take-home exam. We have no computers, of course, or cell phones or anything like that. And we'd never even heard this thing called Young's modulus. We had to go to the library and look it up. And one of the problems was this kind of problem right here using this very equation. And I remember that exam. I don't remember how many problems it had on it. I think I spent 18 hours on it because it was all basically new material, applying the stuff we learned all semester. Okay, so let's take a look at different Jung's moduli, which would be plural for modulus, and from the Latin. Notice bone, for example. Bone's pretty remarkable. It ranks right up there, you know, with copper, and a little bit smaller than aluminum and so forth. Pretty remarkable. And yet it's extremely lightweight. Something like that shows extraordinarily high level of genius and design. And of course, you expect nothing else from the creator. The creation, the designs in the creation reflect the designer himself. Notice rib cartilage down here. Doesn't have nearly the Young's modulus, 10 to the 7th, as opposed to 10 to the 10th. So it's about 1,000 times less, which actually means it can move around a lot. It can be compressed and stretched. And you need that flexibility because we breathe all the time. And sometimes we actually get hit in the chest. I know in college basketball, I don't know how many times I likely either bruised or broke a rib. And that takes a long time for that to heal. We obviously don't talk about an elastic modulus or Young's modulus, same thing, elastic and Young's. And when we talk about water and mercury, because you don't have a one-dimensional water or one-dimensional mercury. This would be for solids, not gases and liquids. Notice that your strain is dimensionless, because if we talk about the length, the change in length compared to the original length, they're both measured in meters, and of course that means they're going to cancel out. So strain is dimensionless. Y is going to be in pascals, because Young's modulus, the stress, which is force per unit area, is going to equal your Young's modulus times your strain. And if strain has no dimensions, if this has no dimensions, and force per unit area is the pascal, then Young's modulus has to be in pascal for them to be consistent. You see that up here. Now, it is possible to stretch something to such a great extent that it no longer goes back to its original shape. And if it doesn't go back to its original shape, it's now permanently deformed. And if you keep stretching it, at some point, you can actually break it. So when it no longer goes back to its original shape because of the excessive stress, you've reached the elastic limit. And now it's going to be deformed, but at some point, and as you continue to deform it, which means stretching it in one dimension longer and longer and longer by exerting a great force of pull on it, eventually it's going to break. So if we made a graph of this, while you are within the elastic limit and applying your force, you get a linear graph. When you begin to permanently deform it, it begins to curve, and then at some point it snaps. And that's the breaking point. Now, for wires, when we stretch a wire, we take a big glob of copper, for example, and begin to pull on it and pull on it to create copper wire, we are in this part right here. We are trying to stay between the elastic limit and the breaking point. We don't want it to go back to its original shape, but we don't want to break it either. And so we can get it to be thinner and thinner and thinner. And at some point, there's going to be a limit. We say that it is ductile. That's the vocabulary word for being able to stretch something into a wire. Now, the shear modulus is two-dimension. And a good example of the shear modulus down here is if I put my physics book on a countertop and I push on the top of the book so that the bottom of the book doesn't move, but the top of the book moves this direction. And, you know, really stretches that binding. And that's what we mean by shear stress, or stress in two dimensions. And therefore, shear stress, the proportionality constant will be the shear modulus. Notice that my force is being applied parallel to the cross-sectional area. And so again, our equation looks very much like the one before. Here's my A equals, there's my B, here's my C. Or going back to Hooke's law, let's erase everything there. That didn't work. Going back to Hooke's law, we have F equals negative K times my change in X. Instead of F, we have force per unit area. My modulus instead of my elastic constant. And then I have my change in X compared to its original height. Because when you go from here to this shape, notice your height here is greater than your height here. And so that's your change in X compared to the original height. It fits the form of Hooke's law, and we call S the shear modulus. And again, you don't have to ever memorize the values of these moduli. In three dimensions, we have bulk modulus, volume elasticity. And now we're talking about a stress or a strain on an entire object from all sides. And that usually occurs when the object is immersed in a fluid, so it can experience a stress from all sides. And again, that stress is the force per volume. And I'm going to have a change in volume compared to the original volume. The change in pressure is the force per that cross-sectional area on any part of that sphere. And right in here is going to be the bulk modulus, which is the proportionality constant. And the negative sign, again, is because of the pushback. So if you have a large bulk modulus, it doesn't compress very easily. And solids are generally very difficult to compress. When you squeeze a sponge, you're not really compressing the sponge, but you're compressing the air in the spaces of the pores that make up the bulk of that sponge. So if we look at a math problem here, calculate the compression due to tensile strength and maximum load. Two parts of the problem. Part A, we begin with the Young's modulus, and all we're going to do is plug in the numbers. Now, a couple of points. Notice up here, this is in meters, this is in meters squared. On a test, I doubt that will be the case. On a test, I would expect you to make sure you convert the length into meters, if it isn't, and I would expect you to convert the cross-sectional area into meters squared, if it isn't. And this is much more likely not to be in meters squared, because that would be a huge cross-sectional area for a beam or a wire. It would probably be in maybe centimeters or millimeters squared. And sometimes they use the word gauge for the thickness of a wire. And you can look up the gauge, what the cross-sectional area of a gauge is on the internet. Now, and you will actually have a lab with wires in our electrical unit in April, where you'll have to look up the gauge number. So this is just a plug and chug. Once you have the units correct, plug the values in. Now, when we go to part B up here, once you have your cross-sectional area right there, you can solve for, and you have your pressure, you can solve for the force. And of course, nobody ever designs a girder or a beam or a load-bearing structure to be able to support the number of people or cars or whatever the weight is expected to be. We always built in a safety factor, and hopefully enough of a safety factor is built in. Here's a comparison of the strengths of a bunch of different materials. And again, look how incredible bone is way up there. Here's a little problem having to do with football injuries. My football career ended in 10th grade with a shoulder dislocation, didn't break a bone. I never broke a bone until my freshman year in college, when right before final exams in early May, I was playing softball Saturday night instead of studying for the Monday exam. Had a collision in the outfield and knocked unconscious, came to in the hospital, and they had to wire my teeth shut to keep my jaw immobile for 6 weeks. And that was a miserable summer. Very difficult to eat. Everything had to be run through a blender. In any case, we have a defensive lineman making a flying tackle, leaping into the air and striking the quarterback. The lineman's helmet hits the quarterback's upper leg bone, the femur. And again, these problems aren't all that difficult to do. What is the speed of the system immediately after contact? Well, this is a conservation of momentum problem. And we're talking about one moving particle, the defensive lineman, becoming one larger particle, which is the quarterback and the lineman as one particle. And so here is my lineman right there. Here's the lineman and the quarterback together. Here's the speed of the lineman, and here's the speed of them together. So we can calculate the speed that they have after the collision. And we take that speed after the collision, and we use our impulse equation, where impulse equals momentum. And now that we know the speed after the collision, we have our change in velocity right here, and we have the time of collision, a tenth of a second. And so now you can calculate the force with which you hit the femur. And then you can compare the force with which you hit the femur. Take that force divided by the cross-sectional area of the femur. And now you got the pressure on the femur. Then you would go look up the actual pressure of the femur and find out that by more than a factor of 10, the leg is not going to break, which is a good thing, especially if you're the quarterback. Here's another problem, again, that looks like buoyancy problems from before. We talked about ballast, something that helps to keep the balance of a boat, and also helps to keep the boat from sinking too low or being too high in the water, by depending upon where you put that ballast and how you can control that. And so here's my force of weight right down here, which is mg, and my mass becomes density volume. We've seen that before. So now we can find the force. We put the force in here, divide by the cross-sectional area, and this enables me to find the pressure. Then we take the pressure down here, and we're putting that into my equation for bulk modulus down here. And there's my constant, my proportionality constant, which I would have to look up in a chart unless the problem is giving me enough information to solve for it. I need to have my volume in meters cubed. Pay attention to that. Notice that the air pressure is insignificant. It's 10 to the fifth compared to 10 to the seventh. And so the pressure we're talking about is 200 times greater than air pressure. So in terms of significant digits, the air pressure isn't going to be a factor. And we get our answer down here. And the negative sign, of course, has to do with the fact that it's being compressed. It's getting smaller in volume. Now, if you're interested, I'll let you read the topic on arches, which has some interesting history going back to the Romans, for example, and the Greeks. And it has a way, it talks about how we can distribute the weight of the rocks above the arch, rather than distribute them across a beam, where this beam could eventually bend. They distribute the weight in several different ways, like this, and then distribute that weight wider through different kinds of designs.